make sure you fill them out before the end of the night. So, we'll start with some basics of, this first question was written, in order to test your knowledge on control flow, to see if you can take some variables, go through a small snippet of code, keep track of a few different variables counts, and see an if statement, see a while statement. So, first, look at this question. You can see there's three variables, A, B, and C. They're A and B are initialized to 3, C is initialized to 4. Then we see a while statement. So we can see A less than or equal to C is our condition for our while statement to go to the next iteration. So in the first iteration, you can see that 3 is less than 4. So we're going to go into the while loop and do the code in the while loop. So next, we're with an if statement, which again has a Boolean expression of if A is greater than or equal to B. So you can see A and B at this point are both 3. So it satisfies the equal condition. So therefore, we do what the if statement says. The if statement says to increment A. So now at this point, A is equal to 4, B is still equal to 3, we've done nothing to B, and C is still equal to 4 because we've done nothing to C. So we go back up to our while statement, to the loop. So, but again, we have to do the condition. So we again look, A is less than or equal to C. Well, A was incremented one time, so A and C are both equal to 4 now, and so that satisfies the equal condition, so A and C have the same value. Again, we go in, so now that was true, so now we can go into the while statement. So we look at the if statement again. If A is greater than or equal to B, A is 4, B is 3, so therefore it is greater than or equal. So again, we're going to increment A. So now A is equal to 5. B and C have not changed, so they're still equal to, B is equal to 3 and C is equal to 4. Now again, we go back up to the while statement and we have to do the condition again with A being equal to 5. So A equal to 5, less than or equal to 4, because C has not changed. 5 is not less than or equal to 4. Therefore, the while statement is ended. And this question asks for what is the value of A at the end of execution. This code is ended execution. And the value of A is 5. So answer was C for this question. For these types of questions, you might get lost. This one only had 2 iterations through a loop. There might be some that have way more than that. So I would recommend making a table of values, keeping track of all, like what A, B, and C are doing throughout the code. And then at the end, you can see which each value equals and then answer the question appropriately. So for the second question, this gets into more definition-based question, which you'll see on your final exam. There's going to be some shorter code traces like we saw in question one. There'll be some long code traces, which we'll see throughout these questions. And then there's also just going to be straight definitions. What does this mean? What Java statement would go here? So the question is, what is the difference between a while loop and a do while loop? So this is just pure knowing what the difference is. So both while loops, I'll go through the answer choices. So A, the minimum number of executions. That we will see that is the correct answer. B, a Boolean expression. While loops always have a Boolean expression to evaluate whether it's the two different types of while loops. So that's not right. And then you can see A, C, and D, they're all oriented towards the number of executions. So a while loop, so this comes down to just knowing a while loop, you can just have a condition. If the condition is false, the while loop never executes. The code within the while loop never does anything. So but with the do while loop, what the heck? Okay. Sorry about that. So with the do while loop, it's always going to execute one time. So it's going to go to the while loop, see if the condition is true or false. No matter what, it will always do one iteration of the while loop. So it has to do with the minimum number of executions. With a while loop, it can be zero. If the thing is false, then the while loop never executes. But the do while is guaranteed to always be one execution, no matter what. So question three is another code tracing question. And this time, instead of looking at what a value is at the end of execution, we're going to go into what's the output. So you can see that everything in here is strings. So we're going to be dealing with strings. So we have a string S initialized to the string literal, object-oriented programming. A string D that's initialized to the string literal final exam. A to the string literal A plus. And then we have string answer initialized to nothing. So there's just two quotes there. It's initialized to nothing. Now we create a temp variable that is equal to the substring of our string S. So you can see we use our string S, then we use the dot operator to call that instance method substring in the string class. And then in this case, we're going to use the two parameter to substring it within two indices. So we get a range. So from 0 up to but not including the index 15. We're going to substring that and store it in temp. So if you were to count it out from 0 to 15, you'll see that it'll substring object oriented, and that's it in string S. So temp is equal to object oriented. So now there's a string named sentence where we use the concat instance method in the string class to combine a bunch of strings together. So you might see ways. You can concat things, you can use the string builder class to append things, you can use the plus sign. So there's multiple different ways you can combine strings together. This instance, they're using the concat method. So the first string is just a string literal. So you see in the first thing, it says answer.concat. So we're building the string and storing it in answer. And answer started as nothing. So this is a totally different new string. So answer.concat, I will get an, so that's just a string literal with a space after that. And then we keep concatenating things together. So we concat the string A. So A is equal to A plus. We haven't manipulated A in anything yet. So we just add A plus dot concat. Another string literal blank or space on the. Then we concat again. And we do the string temp. So remember temp, we substringed the string S. So temp is equal to just object oriented. Then we just add a space, make the formatting look good. And then we concat the string D together. So, and D hasn't changed, it's still equal to final exam. So now we can look at the answer choices. A was just string S all by itself. So that we know that's not right. B, A plus final exam is A and D together. So we've added more things because we're printing out sentence. So now we're down to C and D with the longer concatenations together. So we can see the difference between C and D is one includes programming, the word programming, and one doesn't. So if you remember, we concatenated temp. We didn't concatenate S. So temp was just object oriented, doesn't include the word programming. So the answer is D. I'll get an A plus on the object oriented final exam. So this is just pure tracing. Again, if you're getting lost and confused in these questions, have a piece of paper next to you since your exam's online and keep track of all the variables. When something's changed, change it on your piece of paper and see where everything is being manipulated, and then you'll be able to come to the final answer. So for question number 4, this is again a more definition-based question, knowing the difference between wrapper class types and primitive types. So in Java, there's primitive types and wrapper class types. The wrapper class types can think of them as reference types. So we see the number 7. So first of all, 7 is just a whole number. So we can think of that as an integer. So with primitive types, these are all your int, double, float, string, all your basic types that you get with Java. So so with the answer choices, we know it's an int, an integer. So the primitive type is just int, int. But you can see answer choice B, the I is capitalized in the first blank. So you should know that primitive outside of string, all the primitives are lowercase. So string, pretty sure that's the only one that's uppercase as a primitive. So in wrapper class type, so now we get into an int is also an integer. A double is now, it's also a double, but it's uppercase D. So these get into our reference types that we use with ArrayList throughout the semester. And so these, in most circumstances, just go to a longer formal name with an uppercase letter, in most cases. So the wrapper class type for an int is an integer with a capital I. So reference types are going to have capital letters. So with that, you can see that the answer is D. So we have 7, which is an int, and then its wrapper class type or reference type is integer. So, question 5, at first sight, you're like, I have another code tracing problem, but if you read the question, it says, consider the code and select the appropriate answer of what topic or like what thing is it's implementing. So, it's not, you're not really looking for an output or what is the variable equal at the end, but you're kind of looking for kind of have to use your knowledge of your definitions to be able to look at the code and see what's happening in the code. And also, in these types of questions, the answer choices will probably help you too. Because when you first read the question, you're like, I could be looking for anything. So for these types of questions, it'd probably be good to look at the answer choices and then look for one of those as you're going through the code. So we can see our answer choices are wrapper classes, auto boxing and unboxing, primitive types, and wrapper types. So kind of see that these are kind of the definitions that we saw in question 4 with our wrapper class types, our primitive types, that kind of thing. So now we can go look at the code. When you're looking at a code segment, you should always look at main first, find a main method. That's where you're going to start. So that's where you should start in your tracing. So in first, we can see we have an integer, which that's a wrapper class type. So it's not a primitive int, it's an integer called myInt, and it's equal to 9. So we can see that we then just print out that value. Again, this question doesn't really involve printing, so that doesn't have much value. So now we see we send. So now we have a method called processInt that takes in our myInt, which is of the type integer. So we're passing an integer, but we see the method in our method declaration, the parameter that it takes in inside the parentheses is of the type int. So now we're passing an integer to a method that takes in an int. So now we have to ask ourselves, why can we do that? Why does Java allow us to do that? So there's so much correlation between the wrapper class types and the primitive types. Java doesn't want you to like have to constantly be converting between these primitive types and wrapper class types, because that's just a waste of a line of code for things that are so similar. So it allows you, with auto boxing and unboxing, it'll take those wrapper class types and unbox them to make them primitive types. So, and vice versa. So, now we can see, based on the definitions of, we looked through the code, we found something that seemed, so in these types of questions, look at the answer choices, and then find something that seems a little odd, or something, or passing an integer to a myint, or to a method that takes in just a primitive int, that seems a little weird. Why can we do that? That's because of auto boxing and unboxing. So this type of question, number 6, might not show up on a test, but you should probably know it just for looking, maybe there's a question with error checking. This might, you gotta look for an error, might show up. So, how we declare an array list. So, the first thing with an array list is in the diamond brackets, you have to have a reference type. So that's just a definition thing you need to know. Within the diamond brackets, when you're declaring what type this ArrayList should have, so whether it's ints, strings, doubles, whatever you want for your ArrayList, you must have the reference type inside the diamond brackets. So therefore, you can look at A and B, you can see that they both have int inside the diamond brackets. Those are primitive types. Therefore, you can eliminate those answers right off the bat because they must have the wrapper class reference types in them. So in this case, you must have integer inside the diamond brackets. So now we've eliminated two of the answer choices. Now we have to look at C and D. And whenever you're looking through answer choices, eliminating them, now you should look at the differences and see, go from there. So the differences, the left side of the equal sign, all the same. Now the right side, they both have the keyword new. They both have array list. But now they don't have, C has parentheses and a semicolon. D just ends with array list. So even if you didn't know that you needed parentheses, because in this case, we're constructing an array list, therefore, we must, on the right-hand side, call the constructor. That's keyword new, call the constructor. Constructor is always going to have 0 or more parameters. So in this case, with just the parentheses, we're passing it to a 0 parameter constructor. So, but even with that, you should always have a semicolon at the end of your declarations. So D wouldn't be right because of that. But again, when instantiating or when creating lists, creating objects, it's always the keyword new, and then you call the constructor, and that's why the parentheses are there. Because you're calling the constructor. Even though it has no parameters, you still need the parentheses. So for this question, it's an output question. So again, another code tracing question. So we'll first attempt to trace through it, then I'll show the answer choices and go from there. So again, you should always start with main. This happens, main's the only thing. So we start there. So we have a class sports. First thing we see is We're creating an array called lowercase sports of type string. And on the right-hand side, we can see equals new string with the brackets with the number 5 in it. So that means we're creating 5 slots that can store strings. So the number inside the brackets on the right-hand side is the length of the array. Now you can see we just initialize each element of the array. So you can do it with just naming the array, putting the index where you want to go, and then sending it some value that corresponds with the type of the array. So we have a string array. So we can see sports, our array at index 0 is going to equal basketball, 1 baseball, 2 soccer, 3 football, 4 volleyball. So now we have an array of size, the length is 5, then keep in mind the indexes of the array only go from 0 to length minus 1, since it's 0 base. So now we see we're going to create a list. Again, in the diamond brackets, we have the type, a reference type string, call our list S, and now we're going to utilize a method in the arrays class called where we can convert an array to a list. So it's arrays.asList, and then we send the array that we want to convert to a list. So we send our array sports to the asList method, and we get a list back of the same type string, and it's called S. So now we have a list and an array that both have the same values. So next, you can see that there's a counter called int count equals 0. So we just initialize a count. So now we see a for loop. In this case, we're using an enhanced for loop. So what an enhanced for loop does is you give it the type of the list you want to circulate through. So in this instance, it's strings. We're dealing with strings. So we put that type, string. We give it a variable name. So we call it X. That can be anything. That's a variable name. We put a colon, and then we put the list name that we want to circulate through, or an array, list, whatever you want to go through. So in this instance, we used S. So we're going to be circulating through our list S that was declared two lines up. And what an enhanced for loop does is it automatically goes from the beginning to the end. Always does that, beginning to end. And what it does is it goes to S, or whatever list you're going through, and it, behind the scenes, keeps a incrementer. And it'll go, so on the first iteration, it'll go to S, it'll go to the first index, so S sub 0, and it will put a copy, so keyword copy, of it into the variable that we declared on the left-hand side of the colon. So in our first iteration, we're going to go to the first index, which is going to be basketball. So now we have a string basketball, and it will copy it into the string X that we declared in our enhanced for loop. So every time, it will get a copy. So now we can see we have a print statement. So this in this question, since we're dealing with output, we're going to be concerned with print statements. So we see a print line, so everything's got to be on a new line. So we're using print line. So we see the variable count, so plus, so we're changing it. You can use plus statements and print statements to put variables plus some other string literal and everything in between that you want. So it's plus a period with a space. Maybe hard to see, but there is a space there. Plus our variable x. Remember, x is getting a copy of what's in s every time it goes through. And then we increment count after our print statement. So we can see the first iteration, x is going to get a copy of basketball. So x is going to be basketball. Our count hasn't changed, so it's equal to 0. So it's going to be 0 period space basketball. We keep then count increments, so you can see that we're just printing the list out. 1, everything's on a new line, you got to keep that in mind, and count is 0 based. So now, if we look at the answer choices, so again, we're dealing with print lines, so automatically that rules out B and D. They're all on one line. Then, so now again, we have to look at A and C, and we see the difference. All the names are the same, strings are the same, but one starts with the number 1, and 1 starts with 0. So we can see the count never changes before the first print statement. So it's going to be starting at 0. So then you can see the A would be the correct answer. So question 8, just a basic definition question. You're not going to see this on your final, but you should still be aware all these questions are used to help you understand the concepts, not to mirror the difficulty of what your final is going to be. So a static method is also called a blank method. So static should always be, when you hear static, you should think class. So static methods, variables, anything static is always oriented with class. So that's just a pure definition. You got to know it. Static, think class. So answer choice C, is C class? That's just something you should ought to know. So anytime you see the keyword static, just think class. So for question number 9, it's another definition-based question, just to test what you know. You know, in Glinos, we didn't really implement using packages a lot. I'm sure I took Whiting last spring. I'm sure your program assignments included packages, but we still talked about them, and we utilized it, I think, in the last program. So a package, you could just simply think of it as a file folder on your desktop. So if you have a file folder on your desktop named chemistry, you're not going to put bio files in the chemistry folder. So same thing with when doing it in Java. So a package is like your file folder named chemistry. we're only gonna put, so what goes in it is classes. So we define classes that have similar characteristics. So you're not gonna make a package and then put classes that don't orient with each other at all. So a package is just simply a way to store your classes, just like you store files on your desktop with folders. So it's just a group of related classes. You can see imports makes no sense. We don't collect imports together. And variables and methods are just things that we write with code. So we can't really put methods and variables in some uniform way. So our main is every time you first create a project, and then you create your classes, and those are like your files that you use. So if you didn't know it, every class that you've ever created, no matter if you create a package or not, goes in the default package. So there's always a package, no matter what. So question number 10 is kind of like fill in the Java keyword of what should fill in the blank. So we can see that inside the braces, there's a comma separated list, all uppercase, that we can just see a list of different types of fruit. So this is again kind of just like a definition question that you just gotta know. Usually it's done with practice. So we can see you should recognize this being enums. So you should fill in the blank with answer choice D, enums. So with enums, they're a way to associate values with things that you don't associate numbers with. So with fruit, you don't associate fruit with numbers, usually. So in this behind the scenes, apple, in this, it starts at everything encoding is zero based. Apple is defined to be equal to the value zero. Orange to one, banana to two, pear to three. So that's with enums. They're all associated with values starting at zero and going down through your list. So this is often used with arrays where you want to have some type of, maybe you're like, I don't know, maybe you have like some project where you're keeping track of like the number of fruits in all of your orchards or something like that. And so in this case, you might have a frequency array. At each index, you have the count of each type of fruit. So at index, so this is where you want to be able to say, if I have an apple, I just want to increment an array where the apples should be stored. Well, an apple usually isn't oriented with an index or a number. So this is where enums come in. So I can say, if I have an apple, there's methods where you can say, like, I want to get the index of my, get the number associated with apple in the enum, and then you can just say, increment the array at index zero, because that's your bucket or basket of where your apples are stored. So enums, just think of, it's numbering a set of things that aren't usually associated with numbers. And it's commonly used with array indexes. So again, the answer was D, enum. So question number 11 is also like a fill in the blank definition type question. This gets into the big topic in object-oriented programming, inheritance. Inheritance is kind of one of the main reasons, the main purpose of object-oriented programming, so that we can take our object type or our class and use whatever we're using in different classes without retyping code. So in this case, the main like kind of example of that is with vehicles and cars. So you can add SUVs or whatever you want to add. So a vehicle is just some plain thing. All vehicles have tires, they all have doors, they all have a color, something like that. Cars, maybe associate it, now they're all, cars are all vehicles, so they all have the same thing as cars, or as vehicles, but we also want to add some things. So maybe keep track of miles per gallon, other various features inside the car, but they all also have, they have all their specific features, but they also all have the features of a vehicle. So this, so we can see, just looking at the answer choices, you can eliminate C and D right off the bat because they aren't capitalized. So classes, you look in the class definition, car and vehicle are capitalized, and C and D they aren't. So you can automatically eliminate those. So then we want in the first blank, so we can, this one could get a little confusing. You just need to read it aloud. So the blank class is the superclass of the blank class. So in the second, so in the first blank, we want the superclass. So the superclass always follows the extends keyword. So extends is how we inherit things. So it's how we use inheritance. So in this instance, we want to say the vehicle class is the superclass of the car class. So now that wording might get confusing for some, but if you just read it aloud and make sure the definitions follow with the words, you can see that you should select A, that the vehicle class is the superclass. So for question number 12, again, it's concept-oriented, definition-based. You're gonna see those types of questions on your final. It's just not gonna all be code tracing, so you gotta make sure you know your definitions. So we have to look at the two method signatures below and see an example of what concept. So we see substring taking in one parameter, an int I. We see substring int I, int j. Remember, we utilize the two parameter substring in like question 4, but you can also just give it one index and it'll start at index 0 and go up to the index I. So with substring, should know that they're in the string class, they're both part of the same class. So with that, you would know that this is a concept of overloading. So answer choice is A. So keep in mind, overloading is two methods in the same class, same name, but different signatures. So not all cases, that's gonna come down to the parameters. So one has one parameter, the other one has two, therefore the signatures are different. So overloading, same class, same name, different signatures. Now we'll see in question 13, the other kind of, the other thing that you can associate with methods is being overridden. So there's overloading and overridden. So overridden is the same method, but one's in the superclass and one's in the subclass. So overridden, should think of super and subclass, two different methods. So maybe you have, let's go back to vehicle and car. In your vehicle class, you might have a method that defines the color or something. That just gives it, just gives the car, the car's white. It's a generic color. But in the car class, you might also have a method that defines the color. You're overriding it in the subclass for the subclass car, and then it defines a new color that's unique to the car. So for question number 13, we have to know how to call the method called foo, takes in an int, in the superclass. So we're in, maybe we have a car that's white. So we know that the default's white, and the superclass always makes the vehicle or a car white. So we could call the color, in this instance, foo color method in the superclass to just make the color white. So with that, you should know that you can always use the keyword super. So to call any method, constructor, to call a method or constructor of any type or in a superclass, you can always use the keyword super. And then for methods, you have to use the dot operator. So we want to call super dot foo, and we send it the parameter. So whenever you want to utilize something or call something in your superclass, just keep in mind that you can use the keyword super and then call the method or the constructor that you want to use. So for question 14, it's another fill in the blank kind of, probably won't see, I'm gonna see a question that's like this on the final in order, just like you're basically defining what a constructor is, but you should know the three parts of a constructor. So this is a main thing in Java. We're using objects, so we must construct objects. In order to construct objects, we must call a constructor. So a constructor is always public because we want to access them from different classes so we can always construct new objects of that type. So It's always going to be public, so that eliminates B and C right off the bat, so utilize private. Then you wouldn't be able to access that constructor from outside that class, and then there would be no purpose to the constructor. So now you're down to A and D. They both, in the third blank, they say inside the parentheses, goes to the parameter list. So those are both the same. And in fact, that's where your parameter list can go. Again, just like we saw with the array list, we just saw empty parentheses, which means there is no parameters. So the parameter list can be 0 to any number of parameters that you want. So now the difference between A and D is the second blank. A says you have to use the class name, and D says use any name. So with a constructor, we're constructing an object of the type of our class. So we're going to have to use the class name. So in Glinos's class in our programming assignments, utilizing like in the Rocket class, we had a constructor that was public, Rocket, and then it took in some parameters to define what a rocket is. So the class name is, or the second blank is always going to be the class name. So now in question 15, this shows how to instantiate something. When you instantiate, you call the constructor. So whenever you're instantiating a list, an object, you're going to call the constructor in order to instantiate or initialize the object. So we can see they all have, on the left-hand side, the only difference between them are, of course, the variable names, which can be different. And D has a lowercase o. So which could, in fact, be a class name. You could define a class with the lowercase o. But you can see on the right-hand side, an answer choice D, after the new, it has an uppercase O. So you can't have two different things. So as the object type corresponds to the class name, and in question 14 we saw it must be new class name. So D is wrong because the uppercase, lowercase, that cannot be true. So we can also see in B, see that same thing, but in this case it goes from uppercase to lowercase. So we can eliminate that. So now we have to look at A and C. So the only difference besides the variable names, which can be different, is that A has parentheses after on the right-hand side, and C doesn't. So just like we've talked about with the ArrayList instantiation back in like question 3 or 4, no matter if you have 0 parameters, 10 parameters, no matter how many parameters you have, you always have to have parentheses. So, because we're calling a constructor, and as we saw in question 14, the parentheses are always there. So we go with answer choice A, because we take a class name, happens to be object, which is the superclass of everything in Java. We'll give it a name, O, and then when instantiating, you always have equals, new, and then call the constructor. So new is creating memory for that object. So keyword new is creating memory. So, question 16 is another long code tracing question that asks what the output of it is. So, this course with all code tracing questions start in main. It's where everything starts. Everything's gonna execute from main. So this is now getting a little more complex, where now we're creating objects, calling constructors, manipulating a few more things. So this might take more time, more effort, but also, just like the easier ones, have a piece of paper, have something to write down what the values of everything is, and just keep track and go line by line. Don't speed yourself up and go too fast to where you lose track of things. Just take your time and go. You want to keep a good pace, but make sure you hit every line. So if you skip something, then you're most likely going to get the question wrong. So we can look in main. So we see our class name is Test Prep. And so our first kind of variable uses the type, our reference type of Test Prep. So we're creating an object, again, utilizing our class name. So we call it test one, and then again, since this is an object, like we've seen, must construct it, instantiate it, create memory for it. So we're gonna always have an equals new, and then we're gonna call the constructor. So equals new, constructor, always this class name, so test prep, and then we send it the value, which happens to be one. So now, with this, you might be like, oh, let's go to the next line in main. But you have to stop and you have to see that we're constructing an object. So now we're going to have to go to the constructor and see what test one is actually equal to, or what its fields are equal to. So you can see, you can find the constructor. It's usually towards the top of the class. That's usually how things are laid out. It doesn't have a return type, so you don't see a void or anything like that. Just public, the class name, and our parameter list, like we saw a few questions before. So we go to the constructor. We see we have a variable HS, which we can see that's declared at the top as a private variable to this class as an int. So we see HS is equal to hours studied, and hours studied is defined in our parameter list of our constructor. So that's just the parameter that we took in. So now we gotta remember that we took in one. So now HS for test one equals one. So HS equals one. So now grade is another private int variable declared at the top, equals hours studied, which is again the parameter we took in, which was one, times base knowledge. So we can see base knowledge is declared as private final. And we gotta remember the keyword final means it's a constant. So a constant doesn't change. So in this instance, base knowledge is always gonna be an integer, and it's gonna be equal to 20. So that's not gonna change. In this case, I did conform to using all uppercase letters, which is usually what you do with constants. Some people don't abide like that. For example, in Glinos's class, when I sat in this semester, he didn't conform to that. But that also when professors are writing exams, they might just make base knowledge all lowercase and make sure that you know that it is a constant. You can't just look for uppercase letters. You gotta look for the keyword final, which actually makes something a constant. So now we have a base knowledge constant. Again, we're seeing what grade is equal to. We're back in the constructor. Grade is equal to hours studied times base knowledge. So hours studied is equal to 1 times the base knowledge, which is 20. So now grade is equal to 20. So now after one iteration, you should see how everything works. Now you can move a little bit faster through the next few. So test 2, we send in 3. So we can see HS will equal 3, and grade will equal 3 times 20, which is 60. Test 3 equals, we're sending, test 3, we're sending 5 to the constructor. So HS will equal 5, and grade will equal 5 times 20. And 5 times 20 is equal to 100. So now we see we have in the next line we have a grades, we're making an array of type test prep, which you can see was defined as a private variable at the top. So it was declared at the top, private static test prep grades, with the brackets. So it was declared at the top, but that did not create memory, did not declare a size. So now, before we use the array, we must instantiate it for an array. So we have to do grades. So we already declared it, so we just have to use the name of it. So we have grades equals new, the type, which happens to be test prep, and then we define how many spaces, slots, how much memory we want. So we want, in this case, 3, because we're gonna store our 3 test prep objects in an array. So now you can see that all the indexes just equal all the tests. So index 0 equals test 1, 1 test 2, 2 test 3. So now we have all of our objects stored in a data structure, which happens to be an array. So now again, we see a for loop, but it's an enhanced for loop. So again, you always define the type, which is test prep, a variable name, in this instance it's P, colon, and then the list, array, whatever you want to circulate through, which is grades. So we're circulating through our array grades. So, and every time, the test prep P variable will get a copy of whatever index we're going through. Again, an enhanced for loop just goes from the start to finish. So now you can see in this instance, just don't assume that all print statements are print lines. So you can see there's a print. So this is all going to be on one line, since there is no backslash ins inside the print either to make a new line. So you can see that we utilize our copy test prep of our variable type P, and we use the dot operator to access our field of grade. So remember, grade should have this worked out on a sheet of paper next to you when you're taking the test, so you can just quickly look at the sheet and see whatever field or parameter you want to look at. So if you remember, grade went 20, 60, 100. So it's going to circulate through that, print them out, plus, comma, in the print statement, I was running it, I wanted to take the comma out, so I'll fix this later and upload it, but you can see the only correct values, 20, 60, 100 is what the values we wanted. It's the answer choice D. So that's the answer you should go with. So 17, for question number 17, it says, what is the purpose of using instance of in the code below? So you're going to see this code is fairly long, but the question asks something very specific about the code. So while you might want to go through and check maybe one line of all the similar things, you probably shouldn't go line by line in this code. If you have the time and you want to take the time to do that, you can, but you should just familiarize yourself with the code and not be so concerned of what every line does, because then you're taking time away for when you actually have to do that with an output kind of code trace. So it's going to utilize the following class hierarchy. So football, college football, UCF football. You can see the football is the superclass of everything, goes logically down. So this happens to be in the class UCF football. And again, with our class hierarchy, we're going to inherit or use our keyword extends to inherit from college football. So it's quickly going through this to not be concerned about every single thing in this code. As you can see, instance of is in the if statement in the for loop. So that's that's our goal, to see what instance of does. So we can see we declare some football, some teams of type football. We declare them. We instantiate them. We pass them to constructors that we don't really care about. Then we create a UCF, an object of UCF football called team player. We instantiate that. And then we have an array list declared at the top. We add all those things. I'll stop and do a little bit of concept work. So you can see that we're adding things to the array list of both types, football and UCF football. So, and we can do that with our concept of polymorphism. So polymorphism allows you to create things of our ultimate superclass and add things of all the subclass types. So you can see football is the subclass or the superclass of everything, and college football and UCF football fall below. So we were able to declare an array list of type football, which is our superclass, and add things of both type of our type that we declared it as football, but we also added a type of UCF football because of polymorphism. So now we added those things to the array list. Now we have all those objects in our array list. Now we see another enhanced for loop. So in this instance, everything is of the type football, because that's the main superclass. And that is the type of our array list. So we have the type, and then we have a variable named F, colon, and then the list we want to go through, which is teams. So now we're getting to, what does this if statement do? So we check, or the instance of, which is included in the if statement. So we check our copy F. So we get a copy in F every time we're circulating through the loop. If F is an instance of UCF football, then we print something. So the only time that the instance of, or what the instance of does, is it checks, since we have an array list that utilizes polymorphism, we don't really know, all we know is they're all types of football, but we don't know if it happens to be a college football type or a UCF football type. So with instance of, you can check the ultimate, like, we all know it's football, but is it really one of the subclass types? So with instance of, we can check that, and then we print something. Now we can look at the answer choices. A, it says print all the teams in the array list. B, to print only things of the type UCF football. To print the objects team 1 and team 2. Or instance of doesn't affect the output. So we can see instance of does affect the output because that's the only print statement. And it must pass the if statement to get there. So D can't be right. A, to print everything. And C, to print the objects team 1 and team 2. We can go back and look. Team 1 and team 2 are of the type football, which is not the instance of UCF football. So we're just not going to print team 1 and team 2, which means we can't print everything. So that goes down to print only things of type UCF football. So this code used the concept of polymorphism, adding multiple types to the array list, and then using instance of to only print specific things that you want. So question 18 is a definition-based question, something that you should know. For class implements an interface, so now we've inherited or extended classes, but now we can also implement interfaces. So if we implement an interface, what must the class do? So now you can look at the answer choices and you can see that the only difference is the amount of implementations that you have to write. So there's some, many, all, or few. So if your class implements an interface, it must write implementations for all. That's just pure definition. If a class implements an interface, it must write implementations for everything. So all, so answer choice C. So question 19 deals with class declarations. So we have an access modifier, public, class, keyword class, which you have to have, and then the name, UCF, and then we extend, so we're inheriting from a class named college, and then we're implementing from interfaces named high school, middle school, elementary school. So the key concept in this is that you can inherit or extend only one class. So you can only extend or inherit from one class, which happens to be, in this example, college. But you can implement any number of interfaces. And how you do that is in a comma separated list, like in the declaration. So just know you can only extend one class, and you can implement as many interfaces as you want. So the answer choice is yes, it is correct. So you can extend or inherit from one class, implement as many interfaces as you want. So question number 20 is we have to look for something that's wrong. So we have to look for an error. So these might, with new programmers, or most of you, it's the first time using this language. So these could be pretty difficult to see, but I know in Glinos, for these types of questions, you only have to be concerned with like array out of bounds, null pointers, and like number format, like dividing by zero. So there's only, you can go back in the slides and check that out. There's only like a few types of errors you need to look for. So this isn't going in with like no direction. So we can see we have a class, we have an array list that's declared at the top, then we have a main method that says print out my list dot toString. So the main thing that's wrong, keeping in mind those like three major categories of errors, is we never instantiated, we never created memory for our array list. So at the top, we just declared it. But we have to create memory for that array list, and we have to tell it, and we have to use our array list constructor we saw back in like question 3 or 4. So we need an equals new with our my list. So anytime you see an array list or an object, or arrays, any type of data structure and objects, and it's like an error checking object or question, you need to make sure that with every type, every list, object, all those different types of things, there always needs to be an equals new corresponding with every list, every object. So you should be looking for those equals news. Those, if you don't have them, that's what will cause null pointer errors. So number format is just looking for divide by zero. And then array out of bounds, you'll see most commonly with there's for loops in the code, you gotta make sure that the for loops aren't going out of bounds of the arrays. So this instance, the answer choice is C. It wasn't instantiated. There is no equals new. We didn't create memory. Therefore, we can't do anything with the array list. So, question number 21 is, what makes the code below abstract? So we can have, there's also in interfaces, you know, all your methods are abstract, you can have abstract classes. So the thing that makes something abstract is you include the keyword abstract in the declaration of whatever you're declaring, class, method, whatever you're declaring, it must have the keyword abstract. So that would be answer choice D, but with abstract, you can't, you You mostly see this with interfaces. They only have like method in interfaces, you only see method declarations. So you're just declaring method declarations to be used later. So abstract is, you can kind of think of, I'm declaring something now and I'll use it later. So with abstract, and just keep in mind, and in interfaces, it's just inherently known that things are public abstract. So in an interface, you'll never see public abstract, then a method name or something. You'll just see starting at the method name. So in interfaces, everything, every method is already abstract. It's just, that's a definition or rule that you should know. So again, the answer choice is D, because the class definition contains the keyword abstract. So for question number 22, again, stuff with errors. So how do you know where an error occurs after the attempt to compile? So if you're running, whether you're in the command line running something or in an IDE, it'll give you a list or a trace of where the error started, and then tracing all the, it'll start at where it found the error, and then it'll trace it all the way back to the root of the program, basically. So the answer choice for this is the stack trace, because after you attempt to compile and there was an error, like an array out of bounds, like a null pointer, like a number format, you divide it by zero somewhere, it'll give you an error name and a stack trace. So answer choice B, the red lines in the IDE, is just the compiler recognizing there's a syntactical error. So you would change that before you attempted to compile. There's no way to really know for sure. Well, it does give you some information of at least what the error is, and maybe a few lines of where it traced it through. So for answer to for question number 23, what is the purpose of event handling? So event handling is kind of one of the main reasons people use Java in the real world. It's one of its strong suits. Event handling is used in GUIs. So the answer choice is B, the process user interaction with a GUI and respond accordingly. So in this, let's say you have an event like a mouse click. So that can be an event, a mouse click. So we can have a mouse click, and then we'll have an event handling method that looks for that event happening. So when the user interacts and performs a mouse click, then we're going to write some code on what we want to do. So maybe it's a button, and we hit the button, and then it goes to a new screen or something. Well, we have to look for when a user interacts and clicks the button, and then we have to write the code of what to do next. So in this instance, we might want to go to a new screen, so we have to write code for a new screen to pop up and then go from there. So event handling is with GUIs to process events like mouse clicks. Question 24 is another definition question. So not gonna get a question that's like pure definition like this, but you might have to utilize these definitions in code traces. So you still gotta know your definitions because they'll be used in code traces and other types of questions. So it says the blank statement stops a loop and the blank statement moves to the next iteration of the loop. So we can see that this is dealing with loops, and we can see that this deals with control flow. So we want to control the flow of our loop. So the first blank goes to talking about a statement. So this is going to be a Java keyword, something that we can use to stop a loop when we get, maybe we have an if statement, and if this case happens, then we just want to stop the loop. Done. Don't do the rest of it. So with that, you need to know that that is a break statement. So a break statement ends a loop. So anytime there's a break statement, once, wherever that is, so if it's an if statement, it says, if it satisfies that condition, then break. So after that, we're tracing through like a question or something, the loop's over. No matter if you have like 15 iterations still left, it ends right there. And then the second blank is a statement that moves to the next iteration. So that's a continue statement. So this is just gonna move. So let's say you have 15 lines of code in your for loop, and on line two, you have, or line one, you have an if statement, and if this condition is satisfied, then we continue. So again, we had 15 lines in our for statement. On line one, we had a condition. If that's true, continue. Then it's gonna skip lines 3 through 15, but it's still gonna go to the next iteration. So your loop is still gonna continue running till the end, but it's going to skip the code below wherever the continue statement is in the for loop. So it's gonna skip over the code that's below it, but it's still gonna keep running the loop. So question 25 is another code tracing question, and it's what is the output? So we're gonna have to be concerned with pretty much every line in the code because we're gonna have to execute everything in order to know what the output is. So with this, you always start in main. So we can see that we declare a list of type string, name it list, and it's a new array list. So we instantiate an array list. Now we see that we use an array list method, list.add, to add the string literals apple, pear, orange, banana, plum. So we have five things in our array list. Then the next line, you can see that we call the method noP, and we send it our list. So now we're gonna have to go to our noP method and see what that does. So in that method, in the first line, you can see we utilize an iterator. So this is one way you can iterate over a list. So we've seen enhanced for loops tonight. You can also have your regular for loop. And the third way you can do it is with iterators. So we have an iterator of type string, name it it, and then we equal it to the list we want to run through. So we have list.iterator. So we have an iterator, and then most of you use iterators with while loops. So you have a while loop, and while the iterator has something, then we'll keep circulating through the list. So this is kind of similar to an enhanced for loop, where the iterator it is just going to get copies of whatever's in the list. And if the list has something new to copy into the iterator, then we'll get it. So we create a string, a literal string called s, and we get the next thing. So we first test if there is going to be something next, and then we store whatever's next in our string s. Now we check, so now there's an if statement. So we use a method in the character class called character to lowercase. So we don't want to test both uppercase and lowercase, so we just change the case and then test it based on that. So we're only changing to lowercase of the string s, which we got in the previous line, dot char at. So we're getting a character at index 0. So this is just going to be the first letter of the string that we get. So we're going to get the first letter, and we're going to change it to lowercase. And if it equals, so we can use equals equals, because these are just dealing with characters, so they can be converted to ASCII values. So characters are really just numbers, so we can use the Boolean equal, the doubles equal sign. So if it equals the character P, then we're going to remove it. So keep in mind, you don't want to remove, we're not going to remove it from our list. So the iterator now is the control of our list. So when removing it, we're going to use our iterator it, and we're going to remove that element from the list if the first letter was equal to P. So we can see, if we go back, remind ourselves, we had apple, pear, orange, banana, plum. So that was our list. We have that in our list. So we sent it to the method. Well, we can see that pear and plum both have letter P's as their first letter. So now those are going to be removed. So we're only going to have apple, orange, and banana. So now after no P is done executing, we go back up to main, and we go to the next line, which is cycle. So cycle, again, utilizes an iterator. While we have something, we're going to get the next element, and then we just print it. We're printing it on the same, so again, it's just a print statement, so we're printing it on the same line. We're printing our string s plus a space. So now we can look at our answer choices. We can see that in C and D, it just has all of our elements, including our ones that have the first letter is a P, so those can't be right because we removed those. So we can't have pear and plum, so now we eliminate C and D. So now we have A and B. So the only difference between A and B is having commas. So you can see there's a comma after apple and orange, Well, if we go back to our print statement in our cycle method, there's just double quotes that represents a space. There is no comma there. So we're never actually printing out a comma. So the answer choice is going to be B, because we removed the element starting with P, and there is nothing in this code that will print out commas. So question 26 is again a definition type of question. So a class that implements the runnable interface. So in the API, there's an interface called runnable. What does that class become? What is it? So it becomes a thread. So the answer choice is A. A thread, as we taught, is often used in multi-threading programming, where you want to use, if you have two different tasks, you might want to use two different threads, two different things with different amounts of memory, so you can run those threads simultaneously, and so that the runtimes can get faster and things aren't stalling because one thing is slower than the other. So when you're utilizing multi-threading and you're creating threads, your class, you do that by implementing the runnable interface with your class. So question number 27 is, what keyword should a method include to make everything work in unison? So this is, just because you have two threads and you have some object that points, that the both of the threads point to and access as their data to run. So in Guinos's class, he showed an example of doing Fibonacci recursively and doing it iteratively, and other various examples where just calculating sums too, of where you have two threads doing both the same thing, but they end up having different results because one might read something too fast or write, things can get jumbled up of which thread is supposed to read and then which one is supposed to write. And we want both the threads to come up with the same answer. We want them to work in unison and only access the data when they're supposed to. So in order to do that, when you're writing a method and you want everything to work in unison, you can just add the keyword synchronized. So answer choice A, the keyword synchronized. So you can just write in your method declaration like public synchronized int, and then your method name. So it'll go, It's another modifier for your method. So you can just add the keyword synchronize. So now we're going to get into generics of, so you can utilize generics in your class. So we can see we have a public class example, which is the parameter, has the diamond brackets, the parameter T. So this is another output question, so we're going to be concerned with going through every iteration or every line. So we need to start in the main method. So we create Remember, our class name is event, so we create an object of type event. And then in the diamond brackets, at the top, you saw it was T, which was just some generic type. It can be anything you want at that point. So now we have to actually define what T is going to be. So in this instance, it's going to be of the type number, which is just a type in the Java API. So numbers can be floats, integers, doubles. It's the superclass of all those primitive types. So we make a list of that type, and then we have, so you can see now we use our list called numbers, and now you can see that we're going to push some things and pop some things. So now you can, hopefully you recognize that this is, we're writing a generic way of doing a stack. So it's a data structure. So you can see the push method just takes in generic type T, push value, and it just adds it to our list that we declared at the top, the private final list T elements, new array list. So we have an array list called elements, and we just use the dot add method to add that value to the array list. So every time we call push, we're just adding something new to the array list. So, and then you can also see with pop, we check to make sure if it's empty, we don't want to remove something because there's nothing there. And then that would get, you would get an error if you tried to remove something. So then we just return null. Otherwise, we return everything that was in elements except for what was at the end of the list. So now we can see that we push or add the value 14.2, which can be represented as a double, which is in fact a number. We can push the value 12, which is just an integer, but it's also a number. So this gets into polymorphism. We can add different number types just because we're using the superclass type. So we add the values 14.2, 12, 2.0, 10, and 25. So those were all added to the list. But then we do a pop. So this is going to take out the add. Remember, the add always adds something to the end of the list. In a stack, you can think of, we're just going to have to remove the top. So, or the last element we added, we're just going to take out. So when we do the pop, it's going to remove the value 25. So we just put that on the stack. We got to take that, and then that's on the top of the stack. So when we pop it, we just take that out. And then we do another push. So we add 56 to the list. And then we call a print function, which you can just see using an enhanced for loop, uses our generic T type, names the variable T, colon, and then we're circulating through our array list that we defined at the top as elements. Then you can see we're just using a print statement, and we just print out the value plus a space. So if you remember, the pop took away 25. So if we know that A has 25 in it, B has 25 in it, C has 25 in it, so you can automatically end on D. And since we added six values, but we did a pop, so there should only be five values in the print statement, because that's all the six pushes minus the one pop, we have five values. So A and B are too long, so they have one extra value. And then 25 can't be in the list because we popped that. So 29, GUI layouts. So what GUI layout should you use for text wrapping? So this you just kind of have to know. You should use flow layout. So flow layout utilizes, it goes left to right, top to bottom. And whenever you try to add something and it exceeds the width, it will just wrap to the next line, the next available space. So grid layout, grid and box layout, just organize your things into rows and columns. So you can have a 3x3 grid, and then in each grid you can add different things. And then a border layout is you have a top, they do it with directions north, east, south, and west. So you have four different things on each direction, and then you also have a center. So there's five different things in a border layout. There's a north, east, south, and west panel. There's also a center panel at the center. So you should know what these layouts are and what each kind of brings to the table of what their like basic just default layout is. Now for our final question of the night. So this again utilizes generic types. So we have a compare class as a generic type T. So we create, so first we're gonna look at our main method. We're gonna see we just print some things out. But you can see at the end of the print statement, so you can see that these are printf statements. So these look like print statements like you used in C. So printf uses formatted stuff, all the percent codes and stuff like that. So we're gonna print stuff out, which includes, at the end of the print statements, you can see that we call our maximum function, or method. So with our maximum method, we can see we take in a parameter t that extends comparable. So we're going to use comparators in order to compare our three generic t types. So we declare a max value. So we take in three parameters called x, y, and z. They're of some generic type. So we declare a max value of the generic t type and just set it to x. We'll say x is our max. So then we do two if statements to see our compare to. If it returns a value greater than 0, then that value indeed was greater than the value you compared it with. So we'll set the max if that is true. If not, then we just go to the next if statement. So in the end, we'll get the maximum value. So in the first print statement, you can see we compared 3, 4, and 5. And the next statement, we compared 11.2, 20.0, and 45.2. And we can do this with different, in the first one we use integers, the next one we use doubles, the third one we're gonna use strings. We can do that with all the same method because of the generic types. So the third one, we send apple, pear, and apricot. So we get the maximum of these. So we can see in the first one, you can see that it's going to be 5. We're going to send it, and then we'll have 45.2. And then the max of apple, pear, and apricot is going to be pear, because P is greater than the values of A. So strings are done in lexicographical. So let's say you had 3 letters with the letter A. They all started with the same thing. Then you go to the second letter. So just like alphabetical sorting. So it'll compare that same way. So with that, it'll be answer choice D. So with that being said, does anybody have any questions? We still have. So pair will be the maximum, because with ASCII values, so it's going to look at, well, you can think of it as just the alphabet. So it's going to look at the first letters, A, P, and A. And P is greater than all of those. And also, if you didn't get a survey, please